Good morning, church, and Happy New Year again. Welcome to the online services 2022. These are going to continue to the end of January, and on the 19th of January, the elders are going to be meeting to discuss gathering again in the church building. So this is fantastic news, and stay tuned so that you can hear the updates regarding that. Now, in terms of the pastoral care team, at the moment, Pastor Ty is available until the 17th of January, and after that, everyone's back on board. So if you need to know contact numbers, you can go on the online newsletter for phone numbers. The church office will be opening again on the 17th of January. So everyone's back on board then. So that's great. Now, we want to pray for the birthdays and anniversaries, but I really feel to have closure for our very difficult year of 2021. If you'd like to pray along, just raise your hand and receive from the Holy Spirit as I pray. Father, thank you that we survived 2021. Lord, you know every individual that's viewing this, everyone in our congregation, all the staff, and people in the Ranui community. Father, you know the losses that we've suffered through 2021. Father, you know the hurts that we've endured. You know the stresses, the worries, and the fears that we're still carrying into 2022. But Father, you're greater than these. And we just come to you now as a church and as individuals. And we give you all our burdens and we lay them at your feet. And Father, as you lift those things from us right now, Lord, as we lift our eyes to the Lord Jesus Christ, Father, that you will fill us with the joy of our salvation. Father, that you will uplift us by your Holy Spirit, and that you'll give us excitement for the year ahead. And even with the challenges that we will face, knowing that you're with us, Lord. Father, we just ask for your blessing on those who have birthdays, couples who have anniversaries, and those that are sick and are calling out to you for help, Lord, that they will know that you're reaching down upon them right now by your Spirit, that you're their comforter and you're their healer. And we give you all glory, Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you, church, and have a great week. Seated on the throne.
Good morning, saints, and I pray that you and yours are well and safe in the refuge and protection of Almighty God in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Welcome to our service this morning. If you've got your Bibles with you right now, let's look at the Word of God this morning from the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 12 from verses 1 to 3. Now, I'm reading from the New Living Translation this morning, and I've titled my message, Enduring and Finishing the Race. Enduring and Finishing the Race. Let's read from verse 12. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up. And let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. We do this by keeping our eyes on Jesus, the champion who initiates and perfects our faith. Because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarding its shame. Now he is seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. Think of all the hostility he endured from sinful people. Then you won't become weary and give up. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, it's always good to be in your presence, to come and to look into your word and learn from it and to be instructed by it. Come, Holy Spirit, and teach, direct, and inspire us with the things of Christ as you always do. And in this new year of 2022, and may we all continue to run this race strongly and finish well with your help and your direction. In the mighty name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Now, I'd like us to picture this scene. Picture this scene. It's the race that everyone's been waiting for. It's the race that everybody's been talking about. Just imagine. COVID restrictions are over. Imagine that. I wish. And the stadium is filled to capacity and no masks, no distancing. It's basically back to normality again. And there's a real buzz in the air. And the expectation is high. Imagine that. The runners are stretching and loosening up. Then they remove their tracksuits and they crouch down on their starting blocks. A great silence falls upon the thousands of spectators. Then in the quietness over the PA system, the words, "On your marks," is called out. Imagine. Then the bang from the starter's gun causes the runners to explode and to accelerate out of the starting blocks, and they're off. And the crowd erupts with the cheers of encouragement and excitement. It is this picture, brothers and sisters, this kind of picture that the writer to these Hebrew Christians has in the opening verse in our reading this morning. And family, there are five things I felt to bring to our attention, or to any Christian listening in for that matter, that we need to be aware of this morning. Number one, there is a race to be run. There is a race to be run. Whether you're a pastor or an elder, whether you're a new convert or a seasoned veteran in the faith, there is a race to be run. The last part of verse 1 tells us, let us run the race. Let us run the race that is set before us. Our Heavenly Father God this morning has set before each and every one of us, you and I, our own particular race. And Paul here reminds us to run the race that is set before us. And then later on, before a relatively short time to live, Paul writes in 2 Timothy chapter 4, he says this, I have finished the race. And then Philippians chapter 2, verse 16, Paul is also concerned that he has not run in vain. Every professing Christian at the moment of conversion is the bang of the starter's gun. Amen? And at that moment for you and I, the start of the Christian life or the Christian race begins. And this race is not a quick sprint, no. But actually, it is more like a marathon. And it only finishes when either Jesus returns in our lifetime or when he calls you home. You are not the spectator in the stadium, and you're not the starter commencing the race. You and I are the athletes of this race. You and I are the runners in this race. Brothers and sisters in Christ, this morning, there is a race to be run every day. Every day. It is a race that we must finish. Listen, especially those who are contemplating on quitting. You get nothing if you're going to quit at the end. Zilch. You get nothing for only starting the race. No, you have to finish the race. You have to finish the race. Listen to what our Lord Jesus Christ says. Only those who endure to the end shall be saved. Hallelujah. That's what he said. He says, only those who endure to the end shall be saved. It's the end game that needs to be completed, brothers and sisters. This morning, that being the case, each day, each one of us, you and I, need to ask ourselves the question, am I any further on in my race? Am I further on in my race? I think we need to ask ourselves this question before we retire. Have I covered more ground today? How much further have I progressed? Have I gotten further in the race? Brothers and sisters, how are you running this morning? How are you running this morning, brother, sister? The one who has saved you has set before you a race not to be admired, but a race to run and to finish. Secondly, there is a goal that needs to be reached. There is a goal that needs to be reached. And there is a prize that needs to be won. I'll repeat that. There's a goal that needs to be reached, and there is a prize to be won. The Apostle Paul refers to it in Philippians 3 and 14. He says these words, I press. That speaks of energy and effort. He says, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God and Christ Jesus. I press. What is this goal that we have to press for and to strive for every day? What is it? And someone says, well, hey, it's heaven, or it's eternal life, or it's an incorruptible crown, or it's his benediction breathed over us. Well done and good and faithful servant. And you know, all of that are certainly included in this. But brothers and sisters, this morning, the goal and the prize is a lot more than that. The goal is not just at the end of the race. The goal is what is striven for each day of the race. What is striven for each day of the race. And what is that? What is that? One word. Here's the prize. Here's the goal striven for every day. What is it? One word, and that is Christ-likeness. There's three syllables, but one word. Christ-likeness. That's the goal. The goal for every Christian, for you and I, for every athlete and runner is Christ-like. Christ-like. It is striving to live like Jesus, like how he lived. It is striving, family, to act as Jesus acted. It is striving to react to situations as Jesus reacted to situations. Jesus isn't looking for you to be like other Christians. You do know that, don't you? He doesn't want you to be like your favorite preacher. He doesn't want you to be like your favorite teacher or evangelist or pastor even. No. He wants you and I to be like who? Like him. Like Jesus. Amen. Can we ask ourselves, are we becoming like him? Are you becoming like him? Am I becoming like him? He wants us all to be like him wherever we are and whoever we are with. Talking, behaving, and reacting like him. Hallelujah. You and I know that the Christian faith is not just about Sunday mornings coming to church, going to church. The Monday is just as important when you go to work, or when you go to college, or when you go to uni, for all you young people. And it's there you continue, you and I continue to live like him as well. Hallelujah. Brothers and sisters, you see, only one person you might mingle with tomorrow might read a Bible. But all the others, if you're a Christian, will read you. The only Jesus they will ever see is the Jesus that you and I portray as Christians. No Christian is perfect. No. But each day they're being transformed. You and I are being transformed on a daily basis by the Holy Spirit working within us and being transformed to be Christ-like. And the process is only completed and finished whether Jesus either calls you home or comes back again. And this is the prize and the goal to be reached and to be won. Hallelujah. But there's something else, brothers and sisters. There's something else. There's a third thing, number three. There are the struggles to be mastered. There are the struggles to be mastered. The race to be won, the race to be run, and the prize to be won. I'll say that again. The race to be won, the race to be run, and the prize to be won. And now there's the struggles to be mastered. Before we go on any further, we need to ask, why was Paul writing to these Hebrew Christians as he did? Why? Why was he writing to these Christians as he did? Because they were all under pressure. They were all under pressure. Am I speaking to someone this morning and you feel you're under so much pressure right now? I'm sure there are. With the cares of life or because of situations and whatever else, are you under pressure? Paul is writing to these Christians because they're under pressure. You see, they had given up their old dead Jewish faith. They had repented of their sins and they were walking righteously before God. And as a result of that, they were attracting persecution and were under much pressure and were being squeezed, and the pressure was on. Some of them actually, sadly, stopped running. And others, wow, they were contemplating dropping out of the race. There's someone watching this morning and things have gotten quite tough for you. And you're thinking, what's the point? What's the point of it all? And you're contemplating dropping out of the Christian race. Am I speaking to you this morning? And that's you? Brother, sister? Paul had in front of him a company of dejected athletes whose morale was low, so low. And he had to get them up and running this race again. And how does he do that? And how do I get you up and running again, brother and sister and young person in Christ? I'm here to encourage you this morning. How can I do that? This was the challenge that Apostle Paul had in this chapter. In this particular chapter. So somebody here this morning, and you've slowed down. You ever see the people running in the Olympics? And someone takes off at the start ahead of everyone so quickly, and then they start to slow down after the first lap with a few more laps to go, and it's almost as if they're going backwards because everybody else are passing them. You ever seen that? Is someone slowing down this morning or struggling and contending with the cares of this life? Temptations getting in your way and it's calling you out. Maybe I'm talking to someone and you're fearful. You're frustrated and panicking over this whole lockdown pandemic thing. And you find that all these things have kind of left you spiritually drained, yeah? And you have no energy to continue this race. You've stopped and others are passing you and it seems you've fallen behind. And that's who Paul was talking to in our reading this morning. They were all falling behind. So how do we get you from struggling to surging ahead? Hallelujah. How do we get to do that? Well, some of you this morning might be struggling because you're carrying stuff that you shouldn't be carrying. I remember back when I joined this elite martial arts club for a challenge in the world. Just to see how long I would last with the extreme training regime. It was a challenge for me. And long story short, there were 18 of us who were chosen for the special training. And they dropped out, each one, as the year went on. One by one, they dropped off, couldn't handle it. Just gave up. That's how hard it was. There were times I slowed down and I contemplated on giving up, but I pushed those thoughts aside and continued on. I was the last man standing, hallelujah, and I had finished that particular race. I think the Lord had trained me in that physical realm for the spiritual realm that I'm in right now, and I can understand the difference, but because He is here with me, that's why I persevere. And the strength continues to come from Him. Is there anything, is there something this morning that you're carrying that you shouldn't be carrying? Family, Paul says this in these verses this morning. Let us strip off every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily trips us up. Wow. Oh, there's so much understanding there in that scripture. Is there something this morning, brother? Is there something this morning, sister, that is hindering you in your race with God? You see, an Olympic runner, you don't see them with a backpack on his back, eh? Anybody seen an Olympic runner with a backpack on his back? No, they don't. They only have a singlet, wee shorts or tights and trainer shoes, and that's it. Nothing else. Is there someone this morning, And maybe there's a sin that you need to part with that you're carrying. Or maybe a bad habit that you need to be rid of once and for all. Why? Because if you're honest, you know it's holding you back. You know it's holding you back. It's keeping you back. Or maybe it's a friendship that you need to end. You want to go on with God, but they don't. You need to get rid of that friend. They want you to go with them to places that you know for a child of God like yourself aren't healthy. Those places that they want to take you in, aren't healthy. You might ask then, what do I need to do? What do I need to do? I'm lost. I don't know what to do. What do I need to do? Well, here we go. You've got to sacrifice them. That's the answer. Sacrifice them. You see these runners and different athletes in the Olympics or Commonwealth Games, etc. If they're going to get the prize, if they're going to reach the goal, there are sacrifices to make. And we're shown these sacrifices they make to reach their potential and to be able to complete. Hallelujah. There's no Olympian who hasn't made sacrifices to run to win gold. That's why Paul said, strip off or get rid of or lay aside every weight and the sin that so easily trips us up. What sin do you need to get rid of that's slowing you down and continues to trip you up, brother, sister? In the name of Jesus, get rid of it. Amen. In the name of Jesus, I command you to get rid of it. Whatever sin it is that's on your back or that you're carrying in this race, get rid of it. Hallelujah. Then Paul says something more, something else we need. He says, let us run with endurance. Here's that word. With endurance. And we will never finish the race unless we have endurance. Amen? I found that out in that challenge that I went through. I had to endure. Otherwise, wouldn't have made it. But you know what? That's okay, because endurance isn't something that you bring to the table. No. You do know that, don't you? You do not bring endurance to the table. Because endurance, I believe, listen, is an ingredient that God puts in you and I at the moment of salvation. And that's why those who are truly saved will finish the race. Because God has put it in you. He has put it in me to finish this race. Hallelujah. Now, there are not only struggles to be mastered, but there's inspiration to be taken. There's another word, inspiration to be taken. This is the fourth thing. Number four, look at what Paul says. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, end of quote. Who are these crowd of witnesses that we can take inspiration from? Who are they? Well, if you don't know, they are the people who are mentioned in the previous chapter, Hebrews 11. And we refer to them as, I can hear somebody say them, as the heroes of faith. Hallelujah. It starts with Abel in verse 4 and then Samuel in verse 32. Listen, family, they all had their troubles and their trials. They all had their troubles and disappointments, and they all had their testings and their persecutions. They all, however, ran the race that was set before them. They all ran. Oh, yes, they did. They all embraced the promises of God, believing something. What did they believe? Believing that this world was not their own or their home, sorry. Believing that this world was not their home. You do know that, don't you? Yeah, we all agree. This world is not our home, guys. This world is not our home. And they believed that the heavenly country was better than any earthly one. And so they endured and ran. They endured and they ran. And every one of them finished the race. Hallelujah. Every one of them. Now, Paul was saying, it's as though all those great witnesses are now the spectators in the stands looking down on you and I as we run our race. Amen. Oh, isn't that beautiful? That's awesome. You imagine that. And you know what they're doing? You know what Abraham and Isaac and all those men of faith, you know what they're doing? They're cheering on. They're cheering you and I on. They're cheering you and I on. Hallelujah. Abel, Noah, David, Samson, Jacob, Abraham. And you know what they're doing? They are cheering you and I on as we run this race. So come on. Don't give up, but endure to the end. People, come on. Come on. You can do it. I love Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I love that scripture. It is so true. I've seen it come true in my own life. I've seen it come true in other brothers and sisters' lives. So true. So don't give up. Endure to the end. Now, of course, there are different set of circumstances and circumstances to face, a different age in which to face them. But it's as though they were saying, we ran just as you are running right now, and we persevered and endured and kept going. And the least joy of heaven is more than the greatest joy here on earth. Amen. So come on. We can do it as well. You and I. That's my inspiration this morning, brothers and sisters, family. If Moses, if Abraham, and the rest of them can finish, I can finish. And guess what? You can finish. Come on. Huh? We can finish this race. Amen. Somebody yell amen so I can hear you through the TV right now. Hallelujah. I heard you. I heard you because you love Jesus. Let me ask you this. Would an actor not act with double intensity if he knew that some famous dramatic master was sitting in the stalls watching him? Would a promising young rugby player would he not strive with double effort if he knew the All Blacks coach was in the stands watching him with a view to selecting him for the All Blacks or the national team? I'd say he would play the game of his life. Hallelujah. I would. If I knew the coach was up there watching me and was wanting to pick me for the team, I'd give it my best. Hallelujah. And because of that, that would be his inspiration. And all these Old Testament men of faith are our inspiration this morning for us to run and endure and for us to finish. But then you might say, but Pastor Ty, I'm not a Moses, I'm not a Joseph, or I'm not an Abraham, etc. I'm just me with so much stuff going on in my life. You can't compare me to them. They're great, awesome, mighty men of God, men of faith. I don't have that faith. Listen, friend, this morning. You don't need to be a Moses. You don't need to be a Joseph, and you don't need to be an Abraham or any of them. You see, they didn't finish because he was Moses or he was Abraham or he was Joseph. No, no. They finished because God was in them and with them. Hallelujah. Amen. And that same God is in you and in me. Amen. We'll never go wrong with God in our lives. We can never fail with Jesus in our lives. Hallelujah. And that's how you and I will finish this race, because God is in us by his Spirit. Isn't that exciting? Is it making you feel a little bit more confident? You know, get up and wipe the dust off your shorts and get ready to continue that run again. Finally, number five. There weren't just struggles to be mastered and inspirations to be obtained. Finally, there's a look to be fixed. There's a look to be fixed. Verse 2, let's read. Looking unto Jesus, the author or the originator and the finisher or the perfecter of our faith. You hear that? That's who he is. The author, the originator, the finisher, and the perfecter of our faith, looking unto Jesus. In the race of life, there are so many things that seek to be hindrances. We all experience that, even now. Things that would seek to deflect our focus or take away the focus from us. When weariness hits, when the voice says, you're not going to make it, you're not good enough, that's when our look has to be fixed on Jesus. Why? Because Jesus also ran a race. He also ran a race, our Lord and Savior. He had his own race to run, his own race to finish. And he did finish it. How do I know that? How do you know that? He finished it. Because on the cross, did he not say, it is finished? It is finished. Our Lord was a prime example of a finisher. Oh, yes, he is. And despite them nailing him on that cross and the thorns on his head and the whips on his back and the spear to his side, he said, it is finished. It is finished. I finished. Imagine him saying that. It's finished, and I finished. So he wants you and I to finish. Friends, this morning, he is the one who began your faith, my faith, and he alone is the one who will complete it. My race began back in 1998 when he came into my life, and he has given me the energy and inspiration to carry on. Hallelujah. Blessed be his holy name. It's just like yesterday, I was born again, and I'm on fire to continue. My legs, my knees sometimes fail me at the age of 58, but boy, the Spirit of the Lord continues to push me on and to help me through, and he is doing that with you as well, family. There's a prize, brothers and sisters. How do you finish? Keep your eyes on Jesus. That's how we finish. There's no other formula. Keep your eyes on Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. People will fail you. People will fail each and every one of us, all the time. But Jesus will never fail you. He'll never fail me. In Matthew 14, you know the story. The disciples were crossing the sea at night, and Jesus, we're told, went to them walking on the water. And when he caught up with them, he invited Simon Peter to go to him, and Peter did that. Immediately, he did that. Now, Peter did something amazing, though. You know the story. For a few moments, he did something amazing. He walked on the water. But when he shifted his gaze from Jesus to the waves, what happened? He began to sink. And Jesus thankfully stretched out his hand and saved him. Hallelujah. Praise God. Keep your eyes off the storm this morning, friend. But keep your eyes on him who calms the storm, and you will finish the race. Hallelujah. And everybody said, amen. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your word this morning. And we ask, Lord, to help us to keep our eyes fixed firmly and steadfastly on our Lord Jesus Christ. And give us the energy levels that we need for this race in 2022. And the desire that each day we strive for that Christ-likeness, and to keep our faith in you consistently. In your precious name we pray. Amen. God bless you, family. Keep safe and see you again soon. Thanks for watching. God bless. Bye.
sing Holy Ghost. Spirit leads me on in the power of your love.